Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but not, have not love, I have become a sounding brass or a clanging cymbal.
And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge.
And though I have all faith as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing.
And though I bestow all of my goods to feed the poor.
And though I give my body to be burned,
but have not love,
it profits me nothing.
Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy.
Love does not parade itself, is not puffed up.
Does not behave rudely, does not seek its own.
Is not provoked, thinks no evil.
Does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth.
Bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails.
Whether there are prophecies, they will fail.
Whether there are tongues, they will cease.
Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away.
For we know in part, and we prophesy in part.
But when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part shall be dealt away.
When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child, and I thought as a child. But when I grew up, I put away childish things.
For now we see in a mirror, dimly, but then face to face.
Now I know in part, but then I shall know, just as also I am known.
And now abide faith,
hope,
love,
these three, but the greatest of these
is love.
Thank you all. That was lovely. Get it, lovely? So I know some people are shocked by my haircut. No one here is more shocked than I am. I've been combing my hair the same way since 1973. Every morning the same way, and now they say I don't even need a comb anymore. I don't know what to do. I haven't burned it yet. Next quarter, the Sabbath School lesson is going to be on the minor prophets. I know, don't get too excited. The minor prophets, they're the underread part of the Bible. And there's a good reason that they're underread. The minor prophets are angry people. They really are. A few samples. Hear this word, you cows of Bashan, who oppress the poor and crush the needy. That's Amos. Isaiah says, stop bringing meaningless offerings. Your incense is detestable to me. I cannot bear your evil assemblies. And then, should you not know justice, you who hate good and love evil, who tear the skin from my people and the flesh from their bones, who eat my people's flesh, strip off their skin, break their bones into pieces, chop them up like meat for the pan. Happy guys, right? I just want to read more of that, don't you? Is it any wonder that we shy away from the prophets of the Old Testament? And of course, we love Daniel. We love the prophets that have future prophecies, right? But what about these other prophets? They prophesied mostly in times of exile or in times that they were about to be exiled. And they prophesied generally, actually consistently, evil for God's people. Imagine the audience of these prophets. They're sitting in a place where they are slaves in a foreign country. At the same time, they're reading scriptures that are full of eternal promises of God's favor. How confusing, how terribly disturbing that would be. So, let's turn to Micah chapter 6. Micah chapter 6. Micah is about 5 or 6 back from the end of the Old Testament. For those of you who haven't turned to Micah in a while. Micah chapter 6. In Micah chapter 6... Pardon me, Micah chapter 6 is a lawsuit. It's a lawsuit of God against his people. And the lawsuit begins with his allegations, and he is bringing the lawsuit to the earth. It says, now hear what the Lord says. Arise and plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, O you mountains, the Lord's complaint. And that word complaint in Hebrew means a legal complaint or indictment. And you strong foundations of the earth, for the Lord has a complaint or indictment against his people, and he will contend or litigate with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you, and how have I wearied you? Testify against me, for I brought you up from the land of Egypt. I redeemed you from the house of bondage. I set before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember now what Balak, king of Moab, counseled and what Balaam, the son of Beor, answered him. From Acacia Grove to Gilgal, that you may know the righteousness of the Lord. So he comes to him, and he's angry, and he's bringing a lawsuit against him. What makes God angry? What makes you angry? Oh, we have one at our house. When people chew ice, that's a big one, right? Is that annoying? How about fingernails on a chalkboard? Have you ever known somebody for whom fingernails on a chalkboard is not in any way disturbing? And they can just do it, but the rest of the people in the room are crying out for mercy, right? What makes you angry? What makes God angry? Well, you know, I looked at this, and I said, what makes God angry? And I found a text in the New Testament where God gets really angry, and it's found in John chapter 2. John chapter 2 and verse, thank you, and verse 13. John chapter 2 and verse 13. Here is God getting angry. Now the Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there's a lot of talk about the fact that Jesus may have done this twice. Some scholars believe he did it twice. Other scholars believe he did it once. But he clearly did it at the Passover time when there were great crowds there. Excuse me, my voice is giving me a little trouble today. So there were a lot of people at Jerusalem, and here came Jesus. He said he found in the temple those who sold oxen and sheep and doves and the money changers doing business. Well, it says in the temple. Do you think they were in the most holy place? No. Do you think they were in the holy place? No. This is no, this is yes. I read sign language. Help me. Do you think they were in the courtyard with the altar and the laver? No. They were clearly, very probably, in the next outer court that they called the outer court or the court of the Gentiles. So just outside the most sacred parts, thanks, I've got one. Outside the most sacred parts of the temple, they were selling and doing money changing. Now, a couple of years back, they had a special deal with the Texas Rangers. Before the Texas Rangers started winning, some homeschool kids put us onto this. They had a $15 deal. For $15, you got 4 tickets to Ranger games for a kid, along with a beach towel that said Texas Rangers on it, and a bunch of other bric-a-brac, some other discounts, and a parent companion ticket for $5. So we got a bunch of stuff, so we did it. We went to the Ranger Stadium, and we went and got to sit way up high. And we were up there, and I said to the girls, we missed dinner, so let me get you something to eat. So I went down to the concession stand, and I got 3 bottles of water, just like that one right there. I got 3 bottles of water, and I got 2 cheese-only nachos. And I went to pay, and the man said, that'll be $22. And I don't know if he heard the little cry, but I was afraid that I might start bleeding out my ear, so I paid the money and ran away. $22. See, this is what happens when people get a monopoly on the ability to sell stuff. And so here are all these people coming from all over the country to make sacrifices and pay their temple tax. And the money changers, they had got this whole scheme worked out where you could not pay the temple tax in Caesar's money because it had Caesar's picture on it, and Caesar was considered to be a god, so that was idolatry. Never mind, you could buy everything else and carry that around in your wallet all day, but you couldn't pay the temple tax with it, so you had to change that coin into temple money, which they did. Has anybody gone overseas and changed money lately? Robles, yeah. Okay, here's the key. Most of you know this better than I, but when you go overseas, just use your credit card because then you get instant exchange rate on the day that you use it, and it's fairly fair. It's not really jacked up. But if you go to the money changer, what are you going to get? A bad deal. Hose down. You're going to get washed off. So you don't want to do that. So what you're going to do is you're going to use your credit card. Well, they didn't have credit cards back here. They actually did have checkbooks, but they didn't have credit cards. So what they did is they got gouged. Over and over and over, they're getting gouged. And what else? They don't have enough sacrifice, or the priest declares their sacrifice unworthy, and so then they have to buy sacrifice. Do you think if you were the guy that had the concession to sell sacrifices just outside the door to the temple, that you might have a tendency to gouge a little bit? Every time there's a monopoly, right? Every time there's a monopoly, people jack it up. And so here they were, stealing people's money right there in God's temple. And that made Jesus upset. And it says what happened. He made a whip of cords, and he drove them out of the temple with sheep and the oxen, and he poured the changers' money and overturned the tables, and he said to those who sold the doves, take these things away. Do not make my Father's house a house of merchandise. And some of the other texts say a house of thieves. And then his disciples remembered that it was written, zeal for your house has eaten me up. So he got real upset. This text is an effort to make it really clear that this was no orderly procession. This was not, it's the fire drill, everybody move along nicely, stay in line, okay? I've done it at this very church where I go out into the fellowship hall and the singers are up here starting the service. And there's a lot of people visiting in the fellowship hall. And I say, can we move into the service? And people just look at me like, who are you? And I say, they're singing. Can we move into the fellowship hall? And people look at me and go, no, leave us alone. I'm picturing that next time I know what to do. It says when he had made a whip of cords. What do you think? I think that'll get people either into the sanctuary or out of the sanctuary, one or the other. So Jesus made a scene. He was mad. He was upset. He chased people out. You can't get people out of the fellowship hall with kind words and gentle graces. I'm sure you can't get people who have bought the franchise to sell goats and oxen in the lobby of the temple out with kind words and gentle phrases. You have to get serious about it. And so he made him a whip. And he physically overturned their tables. This is an expression of real passion. So much so that the disciples attributed it to an Old Testament text that says, zeal for my house has eaten me up. That's big. That's not a little thing. Eaten me up is a big thing. And so he chased them out. And here's where it gets really interesting, because the Jews answered him. The Jews answered him and said, what do you show us since you do these things? Now that's a fascinating text. I'd be tempted to think that the Jews and the Pharisees would come to him and say, we're not doing anything wrong. What are you messing with our people for? These people are doing the right thing. They're helping people to come and worship. I suspect the Pharisees knew that cheating people in the courtyard to the temple was the wrong thing to do. I suspect that they knew that, because when they came and asked, they didn't ask, hey, how come you're messing up a thing that's right and just? They said, who gives you the authority to do this? So it's sort of like yesterday I ran a stop sign. Please forgive me. So imagine that you run a stop sign and the officer pulls you over. What do? You say, I'm sorry, officer, and you take the ticket, right? But what if you ran a stop sign and some citizen pulled you over and started writing you a ticket? That's right. That's exactly right. I'd say, where's your badge? If you don't have a badge, you best get out of the way of my car, because I'm leaving, right? And that's exactly what the Jews said. They said, what sign will you show us that says you have the authority to declare this wrong in our courtyard here? And he said, I'll show you one sign. And that word in Greek is really interesting, because it doesn't say, if you destroy this temple. Some of your Bibles may have, if you destroy this temple. The real Greek says, look, you go ahead and destroy this temple, and in 3 days, I'll build it up again. And they said, wait a minute. 46 years they've been working on this temple. What do you mean you'll build it in 3 days? And he says, no, I'm talking about this other temple here. So zeal for his father's temple ate him up. And he got serious. And he got passionate. Just like the Old Testament prophets. We go back here to Micah. And we got these Old Testament prophets. What gets you upset? What gets you upset? It gets us upset when people do stuff to us, right? How about this one? 21,000 children die every day from poverty-related illness that wouldn't die at your house, okay? 21,000 people, children a day. It turns out that every year, 7.6 million children die that wouldn't die if they were your children. That's the population of San Francisco, Oakland, and San Jose. The whole San Francisco metropolitan area dies every year and nobody blinks. Oh yeah, there are a few zealots out there, but nobody blinks. How much would it cost to fix that situation? Actually, just a few billion dollars. Do you know there are 1,000 billionaires in the world? Over 1,000 billionaires. If each of them gave $1 million or two, the problem's solved. It's about clean water. It's about access to medical care. It's about education. It's about clean places to be born. It's about a little bit of nutrition, and it's a little bit of medicine. Malaria kills thousands every day. We know how to cure malaria. Tuberculosis kills thousands every day. We know how to cure tuberculosis. We don't cure it. We put it in remission. You'll be fine. You'll live a fine, long life. But all around the world, people are dying right now. See, that should make us upset. That's the kind of thing that made the prophets upset when people sat fat and happy while other people died because they didn't have enough. That's what made the prophets mad. And so the question in 6 is, with what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before the high God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings? See, he starts small. Shall I come before him with burnt offerings? Shall I come with a calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams? 10,000 rivers of oil. Now he's really ramping it up, isn't it? Burnt offerings, a calf, thousands of rams, rivers of oil. And then he gets way over the top. He says, shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He said, shall I do child sacrifice like the nations around Israel were doing at this time? Shall I start child? What shall I do to make myself acceptable to God? And then verse 8 answers the question. He has shown you, O man, what is good and what the Lord requires of you. And he tells him 3 things. Number 1, he says, number 1, to do justice. What does that mean? What does it mean to do justice? We have some guests here from Cuba. Unjust for many years. And you know, it wasn't just the Cuban government that was unjust. We embargoed, and it hurt people. Now, I'm not saying we shouldn't have, but we need to recognize the cost of what we do around the world. We got to recognize the things that happen around the world and in our own backyard. Did you know Martin is from Sudan? And there's an intractable civil war in Sudan. And most experts agree that the reason the civil war in Sudan continues to implement genocide and kill millions is because when the Christian colonialists left the area, they intentionally drew the country borders so as to maintain instability, so that they could continue to control them from a distance. The Rwandan tragedy, borders were intentionally drawn to combine 2 tribes that had not gotten along for 100 years. And they intentionally forced together the Shona and the Ndebele or Zulu. All over the African and Asian continent, the colonial powers drew borders in order to create conflict. And the conflict persists today, and millions die, and we don't care. Oh, you can say you care. Oh, I do care. But I know you don't care, because we're not doing anything. If you cared, you'd do something. Now, there's not very much we can do about that, but we look in Bosnia. You know that problem in Bosnia? Guess who the aggressors were in that one? The Christians. I shared it. Bible study this week, I have this friend that I always tell you about because she gets my blood up. She's on Facebook, and she was a Seventh-day Adventist, and she became a Roman Catholic. And she actually posted on Facebook this week, believe it or not, she said, I've just discovered in my studies that the reason that they burned heretics was to burn the sin out of them so that they could get them into heaven. So they were actually doing them a favor. Now, this is a rational, intelligent girl that grew up in Keene, Texas. And she writes that now she's discovered the truth, that the Roman Catholic Church was doing the right thing when it burned heretics, because it was freeing them from their sin and giving them a chance for heaven. How far are you and I from persecution? As far as she is from power. There are people out there who, if they had a little power right now, would crush you. The difference is simply whether or not they have the power. It's a scary world when Christians raise arms against Christians. When Christians raise arms against anyone. At what level, at what time is that ever going to be right? That we go off on campaigns of war. God said, it is for you to do justice. Now, I can't very much control whether or not we invade any other countries. But let me tell you what we can control. We can control the thousands of little injustices in our own lives. When a person turns usually 13, 14 years old, they start to get very sensitive about justice and injustice. Anybody have kids go through that age? And they all say, what's the word they always say? It isn't fair. Now, for many 12 and 13 year olds, that's the best language they have for it. They can't get it any crisper or clearer than that. They just say, it just isn't fair. And of course, what do parents always say when kids say it isn't fair? Everybody knows the response. Life is not fair. In other words, shake it off and get over it, right? But here's the problem. Here's the problem. God created in us a desire to know justice and to do it. And when we see it being unfair, we stand up at age 13. Our conscience is awakened and we say, it isn't fair. And our parents should never say, get over it. Life isn't fair. The proper response is, it is your duty as a human being and especially as a Christian to make it as fair as you can make it within your sphere of influence. Now, some of us have bigger spheres than others. A fellow named Gandhi had a huge sphere nobody would have ever attributed to him. A guy named Martin Luther King Jr. had a huge sphere no one would ever have attributed to him. We would have thought that Martin Luther King might have had a sphere of influence that included his church. Who knew it included a whole nation? Mahatma Gandhi, you might have thought his sphere of influence included his rather large family. No one would have thought it would have included a whole nation and an empire across the sea. And the question is, what is my sphere of influence? God has commanded me. He demands of me that I do justice. In what sphere shall I do justice? Oh, at my office? Sure, that's easy, isn't it? Do I underpay the cleaning people? Do I underpay and undertip the waiters and the waitresses? Do I think the evil thoughts about, oh, pick your favorite enemy? What do you want? You want immigrants? You want Republicans? You want Democrats? You want Iranians? What do you want? Pick your enemy. Because there is no justice in hatred. And there is no anger in this text that does not come from love. The prophets are angry because just like in Jesus' day, the temple is supposed to be a lighthouse for evangelism. And the court of the Gentiles, where the Gentiles are supposed to be worshiping, is full of cheating and animals. And in the Old Testament, God's people are supposed to be a lighthouse of evangelism. And they're treating each other with such hatred that no one would want to become associated with that people. And dare I bring it to today? Here we are in a church And if the people can't see the difference between the way you act and the way everybody else in the world acts, that's why God gets mad. God gets mad when his people treat each other without justice. Is there a way that you can promote justice, to do justice in your life? You got to look at it. We got to open up our hearts and our minds. We got to be aware. We got to see the injustice. It's everywhere if you look. The problem is we don't care. We only care when it affects us. You know, I used to get really upset at a few things. I still do, sorry. You know, we have a right in our Constitution to due process. Has anybody ever heard of that? It's a cool thing, you know. In many countries, it's okay for the government to come and just take you. But in our country, they say before the state deprives you of life, liberty, or property, they have to give you due process. That means notice and a hearing, right? You have to get served with some papers. They have to have an opportunity to have a hearing. And then you talk about it, unless you owe child support. Oh, we've decided that's really important. So we've decided we can take your wages without notice and a hearing if you owe child support. Or if you owe a guaranteed student loan. Because we've decided that the government's money is more important than everybody else's money. So we've decided that they can garnish your wages without notice or a hearing if you owe a guaranteed student loan. Or taxes. Or, and at what time does the law become a hysterical joke? Because we've ignored our own Constitution. The Constitution says we have the right to keep and bear arms, but try to carry a sword down the street and see what happens. You know, when they wrote that thing, that little Constitution, that little Bill of Rights, lots of people carried swords. Swords were definitely intended to be included in what's an arm, right? But try carrying some nunchucks on your belt and see what happens. Try to carry some brass knuckles around. See what happens. These are all arms, aren't they? And of course, the Constitution says that our right to keep and bear, which means carry arms, will not be infringed. But we've done it. We ignore our own laws. We make them a joke. There's injustice everywhere. And what are we doing about it? As Christians, if it doesn't affect us, we just let it go. The question is, when will it affect you, and then will it be too late? We must do justice. The second thing he says, what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love mercy? And this word in the Old Testament is chesed, and it means unmixed loving kindness, mercy, and goodness. Doing things good for others. It describes God's covenantal love toward us. So the question is, what are we doing for kindness? Are we doing anything different from anybody else? I shudder to think of all the money I've wasted in my life. I don't know about you, but I have wasted blinding amounts of money. Stuff I've bought on sale that I didn't need. That alone has to be tens of thousands of dollars. Things that I have thought at the time that I could not live without, that 4 months later I didn't remember that I ever owned. Have anybody else experienced this? Clothes that I thought would look great that I was embarrassed every time I put them on, so I just gave them away. Shoes that didn't fit. Food that I didn't want or need. I don't even want to talk about the need part. How much food have I bought and eaten that I didn't need? Well, thousands of pounds between all that I've gained and lost. And the question is, how much money am I wasting today that I could be using for kindness? Kindness to buy favor for God's kingdom. How much do you spend when you go out to lunch from the office? Anybody know what it is? Seven and a half these days? Is that kind of the average? You can go to 10 if you're not careful at all. You can spend 10 easily, especially if you include the gas that it costs to get there, right? Or you could take a sandwich from home that is almost free, right? And so, what could I do with that $10? Is there somebody in my life that $10 would make a difference for? Is there somebody for whom a $10 gift would make all the difference for their heart? Is there someone for whom my willingness to sit down and listen to them for a half an hour would change their life? Is there somebody for whom a hug might make the difference? And the question is, where is my kindness? It says that God requires it. What does the Lord require of you to do justice and to love mercy and kindness? He requires it. And what am I doing? And then the last one, you know, it's hard to be a prophet and not be proud, right? These prophets, they got special messages right from God. And here they come. They're preaching their special message, and they say, this is from God. It would be hard to stay humble, because the third one says, walk humbly with your God. Dare I say that sometimes Christians are the proudest of all? Because we have the truth, right? You know the proud person, right? It's the person who has to correct everyone else. They know they're right. And you know what? Sometimes they even are. But it doesn't make them humble. The problem with us humans is that we were born proud, and the first step in humility is to recognize that. Are you proud today? Are you proud that you're a member of a church that teaches truth? Are you proud that you gave some money last year to the church? Are you proud that you went and helped this or you did that? You know what? He says, God requires that you walk humbly before Him. That means that we don't tell each other you're wrong, except in the most humble way. That means in private. Yeah? It means just the way that Jesus described in Matthew 18. We don't tell each other in public. We don't even tease each other in public about, oh, you're this or you're that. Or, you know, we don't do that. He says to walk humbly before your God. So, the question is, what are we called to do? Jesus said, a new command I give you. Love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. You know, I talked about this in the Bible study. I have this inner compulsion that I feel like we ought to take these important and profound texts of the Bible, ones like this that are so prime, and we really ought to paint them on the walls. You know, he said, you should have my law around your wrist and around the fringes of your garment. And I wonder, you know, when you put it in a box, does that kind of make it of none effect? I'm thinking we ought to paint the walls with the texts in my house. I'm picturing having Sue come over and calligraphy on the walls, the beautiful texts. I don't know that the landlord would like it. But I want to be reminded, a new commandment I give to you, not a new request, not a new suggestion, a new commandment I give to you, love one another. Not a little bit, but love them the way I love you. Show them what real love is about. Give them something. Do something for them. Love one another as I have loved you. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, and the fire will catch on, and the world will be evangelized, and Jesus will return. The problem is that we don't love one another. We're only wanting justice when it's for ourselves, and we only want kindness when it's for ourselves. And so today, My appeal to you is that this week we look for ways to do justice. We look out of the box for ways to do kindness. And if it costs me a couple of lunch monies, then we ought to spend it to do kindness. And that we need to recognize our need for humility, because here we are living the proud life in the United States of America. Nothing can bother us here yet. May I pray for you, Heavenly Father, this week I ask that myself and everyone in this room have the opportunity. Everyone have the opportunity to do justice. If not for someone near, then for someone far, by giving or praying or being aware or encouraging others. Give us the opportunity this week to do kindness. Kindness of a way that will be extraordinary enough that people will see that we are being kind, not out of normal kindness, but out of Christian kindness, out of Jesus' love. And then help us not to be proud as a result of these activities, but to walk humbly and know that all that we have and all that we are and every good moral and intentive that we have in our heart is not from ourselves, but from you. Please forgive us of our sins. This week, give us an opportunity to do right. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.